I'm Billy.
What was it that made you want to get this tour back on the road again together?
Money.
That's a consideration.
That's a consideration. I think we had so much fun last time we did it.
Elton and Billy first toured America 3 years ago, and they enjoyed it so much they decided to do it again. The tour kicked off in Australia, and now the dynamic duo are busy enjoying each other's company in Europe.
I'm sitting across from Elton John. The other guy on stage that I see is Elton John. I'm a huge fan of his. So the nearest person to me on stage is Elton John. So it's not only being a musician, it's also having the best seat in the house, you know? And he's singing my songs that I wrote, Elton John's singing my songs. So I'm having a big chuckle at myself. This is so cool. And I'm getting paid.
Honesty is hardly ever heard. Mostly what I need from you.
Play with another piano player of Billy's caliber and to play with another musician who's written, songwriter who's written those songs, you don't get a better deal than that. Someone who plays your own instrument. There isn't anybody else around that really does that.
I don't have much money, or but if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live.
It does come down to musicianship. I think he discovered, just as I did when we were very young, that music is this incredibly powerful, wonderful, magical, fun thing. And the musicianship part of it is really, really important for our chemistry. We respect each other musically. He's really a good pianist, so I've got to pull things out of myself I might not normally try for to impress him, because there's a little bit of competition. And that's good. That's a good thing on the stage.
Quite similar musically.
I don't think we are. I mean, we play the piano. We wrote both write melodic songs. That's the main similarity between the
melody.
But he's from New York and I'm from Pinner, and I don't write my own lyrics. He writes his lyrics. So there is a different style.
And you can tell everybody that this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that is done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in the world.
It's a once in a lifetime thing. I mean, there's no bones about this. I'm playing on stage with him and he's playing on stage with me, and if you don't bounce off each other, then you shouldn't be there. That's the whole point of the reason why we wanted to do it, is to the chemistry between us. We've known each other quite a while. We've never really played together before, but I knew it would work because I like him as a person. And I think that's half the battle.
Hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down the world. How wonderful life is while you're in the world.
People ask, well, how do you get psyched up for a show? Well, you know, I don't think you need to. You go on the stage and the 50, 60, 70,000 people make this huge roar. And your hair stands up and your adrenaline, you know, charges through you, and that's how you get psyched up. But after a show, the strange thing about it is when you're on a stage, you've got thousands and thousands of people yelling and screaming and making all this noise. It's sort of a sensory overload. And then you leave the stage and you're in this quiet car, and it's like sensory deprivation. It's totally opposite senses, and it's very, very strange after a gig.
Yeah, that's why a lot of performers, I think, find it very hard, and I used to too, to be able to live my life off stage. I could live it on stage, and I could live it preparing to go on stage. But when actually I wasn't touring, I wasn't recording anything, I found it very difficult.
Mm.
And there was no balance, and I think now, though I've seen a lot of other performers go through that, and I know a lot of other performers who still can't cope with the life after. But it is very strange. You've had all this adulation, and you go back, and you're just in the car, and you're going home.
Isolated.
Yeah.
What do you do when you finish the show and you are on that sort of high? I mean, do you go out then, or do you just stay awake for a few hours? How do you come down from such a big
buzz? We go to different places. A lot of times you'll go back to where you base out of.
I usually base out of one place and fly back and forth. And then I come back and have a cup of Ovaltine. Billy will go to the bar and have drinks with his band, and there's a great camaraderie with that lot. You know, that I love to see.
I'm so excited.
You guys are not as young as you used to be. Does it get harder as you get a bit older?
During this show, because I know it's like a 3 3/4 hour show, but if we were both doing our own individual sets separately at our own concerts, we'd probably play for longer than we're actually on stage for. So this one gives us a bit of a respite. I mean, after I've done my set, I can go backstage and have half an hour before I come on and do my life with Billy.
There is an athletic to the gig. There's a lot of physical activity, there's a lot of breathing activity. The lights really roast you, wear you down. The notes, the high notes, take a great deal of energy to get to. By the end of a show, I mean, you're really worn out. It's like being an athlete.
The lights are bigger because it's the stadium, and I do find that I sweat more on the show, and I am tired, but I can't get to sleep because I'm usually so high. It's impossible for me to come back. Even if I fly back from Brisbane, which I did the other night, I can't get to sleep. I'm still thinking about the show, and I'm, you know, it's like, wow. But I tend to sleep in longer in the morning.
When I'm finished, I'm completely worn out.
Songs, because you sing things like Uptown Girl, didn't you?
That's a fun song to sing. It's a hard song to sing, and you have no room to breathe hardly. You know, you're at the end of it. No wonder you didn't want to sing it. Swine!
Glad you're doing it.
On the previous tour of Mary, I did New York State of Mind, which I love. And now I'm pleased that he's doing Just the Way You Are, because that's such a great song, period. And it's great to hear him. He changes his set around every night. He did Allentown the other night, and he didn't do it the night before. And he's dropped Billy the Kid, which I hate him for, because I love that song.
But we're still tweaking. We're still tweaking.
You ready for the Bucks tonight?
Yes, I'm ready for the Bucks.
Yes. You should be a lot tonight.
Yeah, this
hopefully over your side. Here we go.
What's the story with the Bucks?
Playing outdoors. It's hot. There are lights. We're the more brightly lit thing in the whole stadium, so the bugs, of course, are attracted to the lights. So they end up flying, you know, all over the piano, ending up on the keyboards. The biggest fear is that you're going to swallow one. You know, yeah, mid-note. Yeah.
And then that's but he's much better at dealing with them. I mean, he just, like, swats them and gets them off, and I just go... They're going to get the road crew to come up and remove it.
I smash them. But then there was one night, I think it was in Perth, and I know there was, you know, some friends of animal fans that saw me hit a bug, and they all went, oh. So, you know, I actually had only stunned it. So I picked it up and showed them it was still alive and threw it at them. Yeah, we go through a lot of fly swatters on this team.
So you know the words of this next song. Please feel free to sing along, because I'm always worried I'm going to forget one set of lyrics. Then we're gonna have a big ass train wreck, okay?
Tell her about it. Tell her everything you feel. Give her every reason to accept that you're for real.
I knew that I was going to make a living in music. I wasn't sure how. I wasn't sure that I was gonna necessarily be a performer or a rock and roll star or even a pianist.
Career spanning 25 years, Billy Joel has released 15 albums and sold more than 90 million records worldwide. And still, he manages to be humble about his own achievements.
I'm amazed that I have had the success that I've had. It's incredible to me. Sometimes I don't like to think about it too much because I'm superstitious. I think I might put a curse on it if I dwell too much on my own good fortune. But I don't forget who I am and where I come from. I'm still who my best friends are.
I want to introduce the guy in the band who's been with me the longest of any member of the band, actually been with me longer than both ex-wives put together. From Seaford, Long Island on the drums, that's Liberty DeVito.
Got a friend who's on the road with us who I've known since we were 5 years old. And if I start acting too much like a stuck-up snob, he'll smack me around. And this is the kind of relationship I have with my friends. They let me know. In New York, that's the way people are. You know, somebody steps too far out of line, you act, I know who you are, shut up. You know, you don't impress me. And it's good to have people like that around. It keeps you grounded. And it's good to remember where you're from.
We've been friends of yours for years. Have you known each other a long time?
We've known each other a very long time. It goes back to the 70s. We ran into each other in Europe in a hotel in Amsterdam. I remember this very much. And he was already a very well-established, huge superstar. And I was just beginning to become recognized. And we met each other and found out that we had a mutual fan club going with each other's material. And I said, oh, you know that song you did here? And he goes, do you know that song? Yeah, I know that song. And he knew my stuff. And we went on and on and on.
Good evening, Sydney.
He's a great guy to work with. I mean, he's been in the papers, and they say all kinds of crazy things, and who knew what to expect? But he's been consistently professional. He's a great musician. He's been terrific to work with. He's a kind-hearted man, and he's been a good friend.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I'm not one of those who can easily hide. Don't have much money, boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live.
He had a really bad year last year with all the tragedies that happened, and I would try to contact him and just talk to him in person. It was very hard to find him, so I would end up sending notes.
You did have a particularly tragic year last year with the death of Gianni and Diana. How's he come through it, do you think?
He's come through it really well. He's come through it. I mean, he's been through the mill. He's paid his dues. Mm-hmm. He's had his hard years. I don't know really deep down, you know, how he feels, you know, day by day.
Everyone is so untrue.
On stage, he's, you know, he delivers the goods. And he comes through, and he's, you know, genuinely concerned for other people. He's not someone who dwells a lot within himself. If he ever did, you know, if he had that particular period in his life when he did, he's out of that. He's very much an outward-looking person.
He seems to have given a lot back.
Yeah. I think he feels that, as I do, we've been very, very fortunate in our lives with the success we've had, be able to do something that we love so much. Mm-hmm. And you do feel like it's almost too good to be true, and you want to, you know, do something for other people.
Ooh, what's the matter with the crowd I'm seeing? Don't you know that they're out of touch? Should I try to be a straight A student? If you are, then you think too much.
What do you put your success down to? Because I think I read somewhere once that you put it down to competence rather than brilliance at a time when there wasn't as much competence around.
I think it's as simple as that, and I hope it doesn't sound like false humility. I think I know how to do what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to be able to play the piano. I'm supposed to be able to sing. I'm supposed to be able to write music. I'm supposed to be able to write lyrics. I'm supposed to be able to perform on stage. I'm supposed to be able to record. And I know how to do those things.
I just want someone that I can talk to.
You've always really expressed your emotions through your music, haven't you?
I think music really is the language, even more than the lyric. The lyric just kind of helps to guide people into what the writer was feeling when he wrote the music. Music is the initial language. We can go to other countries where they don't speak English and play this music, and people respond to it, and people understand it without necessarily knowing what we're saying.
Most colossal, gigantic, fantastic Elton John!
Elton John has come a long way since his pop piano days in Vienna, celebrating three decades in the music business and achieving incredible fame and fortune. But it hasn't all been glamour, and the face-to-face tour has brought out some memories that are still painful.
I sing Uptown Girl, and he sings Candle in the Wind, which I, you know, don't particularly want to sing again for a while. He asked me if he could sing it. I said, of course you can. It just, for me, it would be not an issue that I wouldn't do it. He's done the Marilyn Monroe one, yes, of course. I wouldn't have said yes, it would have been the other one, no.
On Candle in the Wind, I mean, I know it was obviously made in tragic circumstances, but have you been surprised yourself at the success it's had?
It's a phenomenon. I mean, it just, you really can't take it seriously. I mean, it's great. You can take it seriously in the point that it's raising a lot of money, but from an ego point of view, and it was ridiculous. The sales figures were so big, they weren't realistic, so you didn't really think about it that much. But from a monetary point of view, it's already given them a check for 20 million and there's more to come, so. That's fantastic from a singer. And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when rain set in. It was a tough year yesterday, but you know, things like this are sent to test you. You just have to. That happens in life. Death is part of life. And I have good friends around me, and it was a horrible time, yeah. It was a really horrible, horrible time. I still miss Gianni, especially because I had a daily kind of repartee with him.
Did you really?
On a daily basis to be without clothes. But with Diana, Princess Diana, it wasn't on a daily basis, but with Gianni it was. And he was a terrific influence on me and a dear, dear friend, so I miss him tremendously.
AIDS research over the years now. What was it that originally prompted you to help on the AIDS?
Just basically because I had a change of lifestyle myself. I mean, I went from being a drug addict, person who drank a lot as well, and I had an alcoholic behavior pattern. My life, I had no sense of values. I decided that enough was enough, and I asked for help and changed my ways. And when I got well, and I did a lot of work on myself, and it is hard work when you change a lifestyle like that, and I always say it's the thing I'm proudest of doing in my life. When I got one, I wanted to give something back, because that vulnerability that you have when you're in that situation, when you're on drugs or alcohol, and all sense of common sense goes out the window when you're in a sexual situation. So I was very fortunate in that sense, and it's something I like to do, and it's, I hope I don't have to do it much longer. But until it's, there's a cure or a vaccine or the whole world is free of it, then I shall continue to do it. It's a human sign when things go wrong, when the sand is hurling and temptation's strong. The times weren't all bad. I mean, we had a lot of fun, but towards the end, or towards the last 5 or 6 years, and during my marriage especially, it wasn't fun. It was, it was just habitual, and the loss of fun was replaced by the misery side of it. But it's as a learning process. I as a result of being a drug addict and an alcoholic, I did a lot of work on myself for a year, and continued to do what I was told for 2 or 3 years, and still, I still have a sponsor, which you phone up your sponsor and they check out how you're doing, and it's gotten less and less, but it's still there, and I'm surrounded with that every day, that I'm not going to drink and I'm not going to take a drug. I have nightmares about taking cocaine. They're not very pleasant, but it also instills in my mind that my life is so great. I can't tell you how great life is without all that stimulant. Because it's okay to have a drink. I'm not knocking people to have a drink. By God, I envy people that can have a drink and say, yeah, that's great. A couple of bottles of wine between 6 or 7 people, and taste. I miss the red wine. And it's, but they don't have, you know, they don't want to have four or five bottles each. You know, I do.
Since meeting long-term boyfriend David Furnish, the director of Tantrum and Tiaras, Elton finally seems to have found a balance in his otherwise roller coaster lifestyle.
I had to try and change the way I am. I mean, even since Tantrum and Tiaras came out, I looked at that and went, oh my God. And I'm still a handful sometimes, but there is more balance to my life since that movie.
Do you feel a lot more comfortable now that, you know, the public accept that David's your long-term partner, and is it nicer that you've been able to be together and not have to sort of...
Yeah, I don't want to hide my relationship with David, it would be wrong. I mean, I protected him in the early days until he was, you know, this is a difficult position to be anyone to be put in. Man, the public have been incredible, they've been so nice, they write us great letters, they're so sweet. I don't want to hide anything from the public. They're my public. I don't want to be deceptive. I also don't want to be deceptive about myself. I don't want to have to lie about myself. And, you know, I don't want any lies to be permeated by about myself anymore. I'm free, and I feel great that that's happened. And I'm very lucky that the public, most of the public, have accepted that. I'm sure it doesn't appeal to some people, but you know, at least I'm being honest. I'm living my life in an honest way, and having somebody really loving to support me. I mean, I've had lots of loves in my life, but this one is the person I want to spend the rest of my life with.
You can break the rule, but before you try, you gotta love someone. You gotta love someone.
Do you ever marvel at your, you know, where you've got to?
Maybe one day when I'm, you know, kind of, if I get there, it's 70, 75, and I'm sitting there in the south of France or wherever I am, sitting overlooking the sea and thinking about my life. But I'm still only 50, I'm shortly 51, and I don't think about the past very much. And I don't sit there. I am not a melancholic person. I am a nostalgic person when it comes to friends and things, but not about my career. I've got too many things I want to do first.
Firstly, gentlemen, thank you for this wonderful opportunity, and congratulations to you both on your recent birthdays. Although I think Elton takes the award for
the elder statesman here.
Well, no,
I think our combined age is more than England will probably get against Australia in any of the test matches.
Very good. Whose idea was it initially for you two to team up?
Was it my idea?
I think it was. Yeah. Can't actually remember because, you know, it's the age and the memory, you know. But I think it came from your camp. Pardon the expression.
I just always thought it would be a good idea. That it would just be good value. People who like, you know, piano playing and people who liked our music to see us together. I would like to see that.
Yeah.
Just as a fan, I'd like to go and see that. So we kicked it around for a while before we actually did it.
Yeah. I mean, and when it actually happened and when we started rehearsing it, why did we think of this before? But, you know, it was the right time to do it. And we had a ball. And we did two bits of North America with a gap in between, and it was so much fun. Well, you know, there's two big grand pianos stuck next to each other, and there's not many other people that could kind of do that.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I'm not one of those who can easily hide. Don't have much money. Boy, if I did buy a big house where we both could live,
if I was a sculptor, but then again, no, or a man who makes potions in a traveling shoe. I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift and my song, yeah, and This one's for you.
I guess you guys are in some senses rivals, though. You know, you're English, he's American, all that sort of stuff. You're probably perceived as being competitors in the big, wonderful world that is the music industry.
I think that the perception is from the outside, not from us. There was never any rivalry between us. I mean, we always got along ever since we first met. I really like your stuff. Hey, I really like your stuff, da-da-da-da-da. But I guess the press kind of played it up. It made, you know, for good copy, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, Billy and I, we're singer-songwriters. He writes his own lyrics, I don't. But as far as our songs go, I think we're pretty different. And, you know, because I was probably successful, and then Billy came along like a couple of years later, he got labeled as the American Elton John, which I thought was grossly unfair because he is so American and so New York, and I'm kind of very English. And I never saw, you know, people compared him to me, and I never saw that, you know, it was like chalk and cheese.
If you search for tenderness, it isn't hard to find. You can have the love you need to live. And if you look for truthfulness, you might just as well be blind. It always seems to be so hard to give. Honesty is such a lonely word. Everyone is so untrue. Honesty is hardly ever heard. Mostly what I need from you.
When you released your first album, Elton was already a superstar, Billy. An influence as well?
Oh, sure, absolutely. I mean, nobody was doing it at that time. Since the early seminal days of rock and roll, when you had Fats Domino and Jerry Lee Lewis and Little Richard, there was a gap. And then along comes this guy, Elton John, banging the hell out of the piano and, you know, taking the world by storm. I was all for it. I said, all right, one of us. Actually, I didn't mind being compared to him. I was flattered by it, actually. I thought it was unfair when they said that I was intentionally copying it, which I wasn't. Because there weren't that many piano players, I think, so that's what happened.
Rock me.
Any reservations about doing the shows together? I mean, the expectation is so great. You put two guys like you together, but no reservations from your point of view?
Not at all, no. I mean, I look forward to each show each night because it's the audience comes and they seem to know the words to all our songs. They have, like, they're in the parking lot. They're having picnics. They're having barbecues.
Oh, great.
And it's great. They just, what happened?
And my zipper was down during the time. Oh,
that's like, I have that influence on most men. And it's just, you know, it's a party. It's a party out there. I mean, the shows are 4 hours long, over 4 hours long. And they're very moving things because people just have a great time and it's all ages, you know. It's from Lion King buffs up to grandmothers. So it's great. No reservations at all.
Coming up.
Your styles are very different, albeit within the same kind of loose genre, which is, you know, popular singer-songwriter, piano-based music, I guess. Any difficulties in getting the piano playing and those styles to be so compatible that they fitted together as neatly as they do?
I think over time we've learned to play off each other. We sometimes have to stay out of each other's way so we don't make a big jumble of things. There's a rhythmic kind of piano playing, and which if he does it, I'll play more block chords. If he's playing a lead, I'll stay out of his way, and vice versa. But it's also a learning experience too, because he writes in some keys that I don't write in, and I have to learn to play his songs in his keys. And then he'll do things with his left hand, these bass substitutions, which I never thought of. And I thought, hey, this is really cool. So it's learning. I'm enjoying it. And I'm also playing as a fan. I'm not just there as a rock star. I'm sitting there going, this is really cool. Look who's over there at the other end of the piano. It's Elton John.
I think if you play with other musicians that you respect, you always learn something. And I don't think musicians play with each other enough on stage. I mean, different musicians. And when you do, it's always fun. It's very moving to go to play in New York. And Billy, when we played New York, I'd appreciate to see a New York crowd with Billy. And you get the essence of the man. And there are certainly songs, a lot of songs are here that I wish I'd written. I mean, Piano Man, for example, is just the beast. You know, that's the piano song.
Oh, it's 9 o'clock on a Saturday. The regular crowd shuffles in. There's an old man sitting next to me, making love to his tonic and gin.
There's a lot of his stuff that I wish I had written. You know, at home, I have to practice when we're going to work together his stuff. And it always kind of knocks me out. I said, gee, how come why doesn't he do this one? I'm trying to suggest him, do this one, do that one. It's like, there's only so much time. You can't do every song. But the body of work is really staggering. I mean, you're now recording, what album is this for you?
About 38.
I put out like 16 albums. It's got 38 albums out of it. Just, you know, the amount of writing alone, the stack, it's not easy to do. It's not easy to write. It's hard to write.
Any hiccups? I mean, putting you guys together and the bands and the whole bit, two management companies, two record companies, it can't all be fun and games. Have there been any dramas along the way?
There was one night at Giant Stadium. I guess, you know, I thought the show was canceled, okay? There was a big rainstorm, an outdoor show at a stadium, and I'm out in the East End of Long Island, about 100 miles away, and I hear the show is off. So I said, okay, I go out and I have lunch, I have some wine, and I have some more wine, and they say the show is on. Ah, okay. So I fly there, I go on stage, and I'm 10 sheets to the wind. Now he's clean and sober. And I'm up on stage while he's doing his set. I'm tying his shoes together. I'm laying down on top of the piano like Michelle Pfeiffer. And I'm, you know, blitzed out of my skull. Somebody wrote me a letter and they said, you know, if I'd been that drunk, they would have, they'd throw the fans out. How come they didn't throw him out? He took me out to lunch the next day. He says, are you okay?
And how Elton was at the end of the piano glowering, I suppose.
It's weird because, you know, I used to be very flamboyant, and I used to drink a lot, and I used to drink before I go on stage and drink on stage as well. And I used to be far more flamboyant on stage than I am now, like kicking the piano and, you know, somersaults. He's the more flamboyant one. I sit there and it's kind of like the Queen Mother and sort of play him and watch what's going on. And
there was one other thing, the bands and the crews all get along together pretty well, too. One night, my drummer had an allergic reaction, and he went into toxic shock. We didn't know what was going on. It looked like he was really seriously ill. Walked away from the drums and collapsed in the middle of a set. And we thought, my God, what's wrong? Now, the audience is sitting there. They don't know what's going on. And we're in a real quandary. What do we do? His drummer, Charlie, right?
Yeah.
Came out and played our songs that we had never rehearsed them at all. I mean, the guy was a hero. Mm. And the crowd was rooting for him. Charlie, yay, Charlie. And we got through the set, you know, thankfully, because of working with his musicians. Mm. So things like that.
I remember that particular night because Liberty just collapsed. And someone said, oh, my God, it's Shellfish. And I said to Billy, oh, God, Liberty has collapsed. It's Shellfish. He said, oh, have Shellfish open. I never forget so funny.
We send shrimp to his room all the time.
Next, the...
Is it a bit of a bonding experience for you both?
I think so.
Oh, I think so, yeah. I think we've both been through a lot of personal pain, a lot of bad times, a lot of great times. And I think we've come out the other end now, both of us, to a point with our music and ourselves where we're very comfortable with everything.
Yeah, I mean, in a business where there's a lot of backbiting and a lot of nasty people, you know, this turns out to be a person who's a very kind soul. He threw a nice party for me, too, on a birthday when we were on the road. It wasn't as crazy as the party you just had.
For yourself.
But we were in London, and there was this big soiree at this park in London.
Yeah,
and,
the Belvedere restaurant in Holland Park.
Yeah, I'm sitting there, and there's Joan Collins at the table. Mm-hmm. Thinking, hey, this is pretty cool. Yeah. And there was Kim Wilde was there.
Yeah.
And now he's going through a divorce. It was kind of a tough time for me. And I leaned over, and I said, help me, who is that beautiful blonde across the room? He goes, oh, that's Davy Johnston, my guitar player. I said, never mind.
Favorite song? Favorite Elton John song?
Wow, there's so many. I really like Goodbye Yellow Brick Road. The construction, the chord construction, that song is brilliant. And I like the ones we're doing. I like Candle in the Wind.
Seems to me you live your life like a candle in the wind. Never know who to cling to. Your candle burned out long before your legend ever did.
I mean, for me, I think Just the Way You Are is the equivalent of your song. It's something that you could sing every night, or I could sing every night, and just be very happy singing it. But there's a song called Lullaby, which he wrote about his daughter, which I think on the last tour that we did, it's just a great song, called Construction Mind. Lyrically, it's a very beautiful song.
Good night, my angel, now it's time to dream. And dream how wonderful your life will be. Someday your child may cry, and if you sing this lullaby, then in your heart there will always be a part of me.
Do you think you bring out the best in each other?
I think so, yeah.
There has to be a bit of a competitive streak.
Oh, well, yeah. He is a really good piano player. And if you try to keep up with him, and sometimes we're jamming on Benny and the Jets, when do I get the G part and you take the F part?
Oh, you can do the G part.
Okay.
Well, on the next show, you get the G spot. if you play with someone who's good and you still want to improve, I mean, I'm 50 years old and I made 38 albums, but I'm still looking to improve and I'm still looking for the greatest song in the world and still, you know, I'll never find it, I'll never write the greatest song in the world, but that keeps you on that quest for the grail. And if you're playing with someone excellent who writes great songs and plays great piano and sings well, then, and you're playing opposite them every night, it's a challenge, and it is competitive in a way, but it's just good. It keeps you, they say in the music industry, keeps your chops good, and the chops mean you're playing, and it's good. If you were playing with someone who was just substandard, you know, you'd be on cruise control.
I guess that brings up the inevitable question: when are you going to record together?
Yeah, that's a good question.
That's a moot point at the moment. When we can find something that we want to record together. That's it, basically.
Why don't you write a song together?
We started to do that.
Yeah.
We came up with something and we said, let's give it another shot. And we're still in the process of trying to pick out material.
We're trying to find something that's not predictable.
He's Elton John, I'm Billy Joel. We're not joined at the hip.
No.
And we each have our own way of writing, we each have our own way of recording. And we just, you can't all of a sudden think like a cyclops, like one person. You know, it's
like a 12-inch disco melody of all our, disco medley of all our hits.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Well, you could knock up some lyrics, Billy, and fax them across. That system works pretty well.
I haven't been, I'm not writing lyrics lately. I'm kind of off lyrics.
He's writing piano music.
I'm writing classical music.
Great, these record companies are just breathing fire down his neck. Billy.
they're Billy, when are you going to write a song? Billy. It's like,
that's what you said to me. So, are you in the studio yet? I said, no. He says, your wife's been married 3 times since the last time you recorded.
She did the artwork for, Chrissy did the artwork for the last album. And I said, hey, she's married the guy in the helicopter. And then she got married again. And you haven't done another album yet. But that, you know, he's just doing what he wants to do.
I thought you were sworn off just the way you are. I was surprised to hear you open your solo set with that.
That's the first time I've done that song since maybe the early 80s. I just haven't done it. It's actually not bad in this context.
It's a great song. Mm. It's a great song. It's just because it's about your first wife that you don't do it.
Well, I said, this is for you. And she said, oh, does that mean I get the publishing? So it kind of took the edge off it.
So what's the line you sing? She took the how? Was it?
Oh, that was Liberty. My drummer is great at that. He said she instead of singing, "I love you just the way you are," he yells out, "She got the house, she got the car."
Is there a reality that we will see a Billy Joel Elton John single?
I'd love there to be one, but unless it's great, then why would we want to do it? If, you know, I don't want to do the Harlem Shuffle, I don't want to do something like that. It would be too easy. If you could find a really great unknown song that someone did before,
now we're going to get flooded with tapes.
I'm sure every songwriter or publisher is like celebrating at the Beatles. So the Australian tour is something that obviously everyone's pretty excited about.
Well, we do about 4 songs usually at the beginning, and then we do a set each in which we both come on during each other's set, and then there's an interval, and then at the end there's about 45 minutes barnstorming stuff, and it really works. It works because you feel that it's a show that's been put together, and not just two artists on stage who are playing just their sets. And I've done that before, and I've toured with artists, and it hasn't really been a feeling of sort of a togetherness feeling. This one definitely is.
It's great. They know all the words. Sometimes when during
we
his set,
but they know. Yeah,
I'll go out and I'll be watching him, and the audience is just singing every word. And I said, this is so cool.
He does a song called Italian Restaurant, which is a long song. And I've been saying that, and the audience know every word. I mean, it's a long song, and it's a difficult song to sing because it's a slow part. It starts slow, and then it's a really fast part, and the audience going, blah, 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 and they're keeping up with him. So, you know, it's great. That's very gratifying to see that.
Well, without wishing to overstate it, I think everybody in the room knows every word of every song played on the night. And, you know, between you, you've made some of the most memorable music of the past 3 decades, and long may that continue.
Thank you.
I thank you, gentlemen.
And we look forward to seeing you all in Australia. Be fun.
Sing out the song of the piano man. Sing out the song tonight. Well, we're all in the mood for a melody. You got us feeling all right.
Good evening. For over 25 years, they've been two of the colossi of the rock music world. Indeed, the two of them, with just a few others really, have dominated popular music. Sir Elton John and Billy Joel, piano players, both of them, writers of some of the great, most beloved songs of our time. Elton John, of course, burst onto the scene with your song, Billy Joel with Piano Man. Dramatic, distinctive songs we took straight to our hearts. And what brilliant careers they both had since then, in a business in which the end can come as lightly as an eyelid blinks. Careers of dizzying elevation, adulation, honours and intimations of immortality, but careers also in which they've both known periods of heartbreaking, unutterable despair, from which they've both recovered, both battled on and endured. And they opened their Australian tour last night, or Australasian tour last night in Perth, and yesterday we made a mad dash all the way across to Perth and back through the night and spoke to them both in Perth. Spoke to them of those careers of fame, of the lost years, and their friendship, and goodbye, England's Rose.
I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift and my song, yeah, and this one's for you. And you can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in the world how wonderful life is while you're in the world.
When did you get to know each other, and how did you get to know each other?
In a hotel in Amsterdam, in a snowstorm, and we met and we got on like a house on fire. We were always supposed to be terrible rivals, you know, because he was supposed to be the American Elton John and blah, 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 and, you know, the two piano players, so you're not supposed to get on, and all this is cooked up by the media. And we got on like a house on fire. I mean, instantly, he has a great sense of humor. I think I do too. And it was like we've known each other for ages, and we just talk music and stuff like that.
Do you remember the first time you heard an Elton John song? Was it your song?
The first song I heard wasn't your song, but I think it was the Holy Moses.
The Border Song, something like that.
Something like that.
What was the first Billy Joel song you heard?
Piano Man, and I was livid.
Now John at the bar is a friend of mine. He lets me buy drinks for free.
Well, not livid. I just thought it was, God, this is the Quentin. No one's ever going to write a better song about a piano player than this song. And I know, lyrically and musically, I just thought it was terrific. And it was simple, too. You know, when you play the piano, it's very hard sometimes to write simple music. On a guitar, you tend to have three or four chords, and that's right. It. And you can make sound something. With the piano, it's a different structure altogether. And this song that he wrote with the harmonica and the piano was so like a Dylan song. And I thought, God, he's written a Dylan song for the piano. So that's the biggest compliment I could play him.
I remember I was broke in California when I first heard that song. It was a wonderful song.
I was living in California when I wrote it. It was about a piano bar in California, as a matter of fact.
Yes, I kept going to piano bars hoping to find you.
We've all done it, don't worry.
Of course, you became much closer, I think, back in the early 90s because your marriage broke up and Elton was very... You've said that Elton was very helpful to you during that time, very supportive. In what way?
He's a good guy. He's got a good heart. That's public knowledge. And I was going through a rough time. He knew I was going through a rough time. And it was my birthday, and all this stuff had happened, and we were in England. We were in London. And
no, we were in London, yeah.
And they threw a party for me. And, you know, he's got his, you know, life. He's got to live, and he's, you know, got things. He's a very busy guy, but they took the time to throw a party, a big soiree in this park. Celebrities come, and Joan Collins, and Eric Clapton, and Kim Wilde.
Yeah.
Was that who it was?
There was a lot of people there.
Well, for my birthday party, I was sitting there going, this is pretty cool. And, you know, it kind of lifted my spirits, and he was just a good friend of me when I was going through a rough time.
Well, I've been through a rough time myself, so when I could see him going through one, it's like, there are danger signs here. And you know, just took him out to lunch one day in New York and said, be careful here. You know, I don't want you to nose up the way that I did. And, you know, that was fine. I did it and I thought, well, I hope he doesn't take offense at this. But I think if you care about someone, you have to do that.
That meant a lot to me, though. That was important to me, that he said, I care about you and I'm worried about you. It really was, it all came down to, I missed my daughter and I wanted to see my daughter more and I was having difficulty seeing her.
And I said, if you continue the way you are, you're not going to see her at all.
And I think, too, you found your house having fewer and fewer things in it. And so Elton would ring you up and say, you know, there's an antique auction on somewhere. So would you go to the auctions together?
I've never been to an antique auction in my life, actually, because I'm so much of a compulsive person, I'd probably buy everything just to be, you know, just to outbid the next person. So I advised Billy on some things. In New Orleans, he went out to New Orleans and bought some things because, you know, his house got a little cleaned out after, you know, two or three marriages have gone back. You know. It's like, hello, what have I got left?
Yeah, I came home from a tour and everything was gone. I said, oh, I guess I need some more stuff. And I would call him up. I said, have you heard of this place? Have you heard of that place? He goes, you've got to go here when you're in Dallas. You've got to go here when you're in New Orleans.
See, which is another matter. You're both such big stars, huge stars. Can either of you go anywhere any more in your own countries? I mean, can you go out?
I can,
and you have to. I mean, you just don't shut yourself away and become a recluse. I mean, I was chairman of a soccer club for a long time, so I mean, I'm used to verbal abuse, and that's the only time I've had it, and it was good-natured, and it was fine. But yes, otherwise you miss life completely if you don't go out and see things. I mean, one of the great things that Gianni Versace was my friend, and he used to take me to museums, churches, people's houses to see works of art, and it was an education. And you have to go out and see things. I mean, you know, I don't want to sit in a room all the time.
Yeah, there can be a fortress mentality that some people may get from fame, which is very, very destructive, whether you walk around with a mask or you walk around with loads of bodyguards around you. And
have you ever got into that fortress mentality?
No. It really draws more attention to you than you would normally have if you just went on your own.
Tends to happen more in America.
You know what happens? I'll go somewhere, and people may look at me and go, look at that guy trying to pass himself off as Billy Joel. You know, I mean, what would Billy Joel be doing here? And that's how it works for you.
It does attract more attention. I mean, I'm more careful now since Johnny got shot. I do have protection sometimes, which it kind of took away my freedom. When I drive around Atlanta where I have an apartment, and I used to drive around on my own and everything like that, and I just can't take the chance now for me, I do it. But for my family and people who love me, I say, please don't. Just have someone there. And that's the freedom that's been taken away by the fact that America has these crazy gun laws, that anyone can have one.
So Elton John,
there's a pressure from a record company. They want product, as they say. There's a pressure from a number of ancillary agencies. Sure, they want you to continue having the success, but the biggest pressure is your own. The thing that got you there in the first place is really the pressure that's going to continue, your own ambition, your own desire, your own drive, I think.
Yeah. I'm still basically the same kind of fan that I was when I started out. I mean, the first 5 years of my success in America, I couldn't believe it was happening to me and that my records were above people that I've idolized all my life. And I've still got that same drive. I'm a terrible workaholic and I like to, you know, there is the pressure of, you know, can you top this song, can you top that? Because you always think that the latest song that you've written is probably your best, and then in 6 or 9 months' time you look back in hindsight and find that it isn't. I like pressure, I thrive on it. Because it keeps me going, it keeps me, you know, I don't sit back and say, oh, well, I've done this and I've done that and now I can afford to do nothing. I'm not the sort of person that can do nothing. I genuinely love the competition.
He works much harder than I do. He's always working.
Yeah.
When I work very, very, very hard. When I don't work, I don't work at all.
Ongoing support, you mentioned, too, from the British fans. I mean,
through some very tough times.
Yes, I've had incredibly loyal support. Yeah. I mean, I've been very open about my life, about the drug addiction, the homosexuality,
and they love
the troubles, and they still, you know, I have hardly had any negative letters. You get the odd one or two. But that's to be, I've been very open and honest, and people have supported me. I've been very fortunate like that. I think it's much easier in the business that I'm in than someone who has, you know, like a job in a bank or whatever.
Or Lord Chancellor.
Yeah, or a Lord Chancellor, or someone high in a political office. Or a film star.
Goodbye, Rose.
Last year, Elton, a very big year for you, and you sang Goodbye, English Rose that day at Westminster Abbey at Diana's funeral. How important was it to you that you do that well?
It was the most important thing of my career, not only just from a performing standpoint of view, but because there were so many people who were watching, 2.5 billion people watching, who, you know, were genuinely upset and moved by the whole death of Princess Diana. It was important that I pulled it off and I sang it without breaking down, which was the hardest thing to do. So I mean, with 30 years of performing experience, one can do that. One can turn yourself off and steel yourself to do that. It was difficult. I had a teleprompter because I thought, you know, I've sung this song so many times. If I suddenly sing Goodbye, Norma Jean, then, you know, my head's going to come off and I'm never going to be able to appear in public again. So, it was my experience that carried through. I wanted to sing it well for her family and for everyone in Britain. I've lived in Britain all my life, and I've never seen a situation like that before, when there was so much grieving and so much. It was quite incredible.
Were you watching this, Billy, on television?
Yeah, I did. I was trying to project how it must have felt to be doing this song when he was doing this song, and what a struggle it must have been. I've seen him perform many times, and I know what he must have been feeling. I mean, I don't know exactly, but I know some of what he must have been feeling. And the next time I saw him, when we were in New York, we just ran into each other in the street in New York City. He jumped out of a car. I was walking down the street, and I gave each other a hug, and I said, "How did you get through the song?" And he said pretty much the same thing he told you. You just have to call on your really professional reserve.
Yeah. Elton, tell us the story of how Goodbye English Rose came about. Is it true that we're having a conversation with Bernie Taupin on the telephone, and the line was scratchy, and Bernie thought that you said you wanted new lyrics for Norma Jean, is that right? Or
no, the actual story is, I rang Bernie up and I said, "Listen, I might be singing at the funeral. Everybody seems to be picking on Candle in the Wind." When they came out from signing the book, people said, "Well, I just wrote a line from Candle in the Wind." I said, "I'm not so sure whether we should sing Candle in the Wind." I said, "Anyway, with the lyric, we'd have to change the lyric. Maybe we should write a new song altogether." And Bernie said, "No, absolutely not, because everybody knows that melody. It's a better idea if I rewrite the lyrics." I said, "Okay, go ahead." And 2.5 hours later, I had them on my fax machine.
You've said that you will never do English Rose again. Does that mean you won't do Norma Jean either?
Probably not.
But you get round that, don't you, in the concert, in your...
Well, Billy chose to do it, and he asked me, would it upset me if he did? And I said, "Of course not.
I'm going to do Goodbye, Norma Jean."
Would have liked to have known you, well, but I was just a key. You can't go burn down long before you let it never do.
We do, yeah, of course. We wouldn't do it if we didn't. I mean, it would be such an easy gig to do and just come on stage, and there's a little competition, there's a little rivalry in the such that it's front, and he's looking at me and I'm looking at him and he's trying to make me laugh. And we trade riffs in Benny the Jets and other songs. Yeah, of course. It's so enjoyable, and you know, to be pushed by another good musician and singer.
So you've got this Australasian tour, and then Elton, what about your Oscars party? You always have a party after the Oscars.
I fly from Melbourne on the 22nd. I arrive in Los Angeles on the 22nd. The Oscars is on the 23rd. And I fly to Osaka on the 24th, which means I don't have a birthday this year.
No party this year?
No, well, I miss it. The 25th doesn't exist for me this year.
It's gone.
No, it's gone, so I'm staying at 50. So he'll be one year nearer me.
There you go.
Getting it.
Of course, the other extraordinary thing about the both of you is you've crossed the generations. You appeal to, what, two generations now? Would it be three?
I don't know. Look, we can...
Three, I would think. I mean, he's got the same sort of audience that I do. And you get grandmothers, daughters, and granddaughters coming.
Babes in arms.
Yeah, babes in arms at the front of the stage. Mm. You know, it's very rewarding. I to write music, you want it to be accepted by everybody and everyone to like it. No matter, I'm so grateful that I'm that sort of musician that doesn't actually write music for one set of people. because that's, you know, there's going to be an end to that career.
Does it amaze you when you're driving along and you hear on the radio they're still playing Piano Man? Does it amaze you they're still playing your song?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Do you always turn it up.
Do you turn it up?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Do you still like it?
I like it when it comes on the radio. I wouldn't program it myself at home, only because I'm tired of it. From, you know, writing it and arranging it and producing it and recording it and videoing it and touring it. But then if it comes on that somebody else decided to program it, well, that's a different thing.
It doesn't matter, yeah.
Zoom, the volume goes way up.
You've both had, and are having, incredibly successful careers. But you both had your highs, both had your lows. Would you change anything if you could do it again, Billy? Do you have regrets?
I've done some, bad business deals. I've had some misfortunes with relationships. I've been naive a lot of times. I'm not, you know, the Edith Piaf, je ne regret. I have plenty of regrets, but I've lived, man. Mm. You know, and I'm here to tell the tale.
Do you regret Elton?
I regret hurting a lot of people, wasting a lot of my time. I wasted 16 years of my life, which, when I say 16, that's the total years that I did cocaine. And I know it's an awful lot of verbal garbage and spending time being so self-obsessed when I could have been doing. I mean, I'd rather go to a porcelain show now than I would a rock and roll concert. You know, so I mean, I that to me is a lie. Oh, God, there's a great porcelain exhibition. I'm there. Rock and roll concert. I've wasted a lot of time and a lot of learning capacity.
Well, you must be very honored with that knighthood.
It's I love my country, and to be recognized in such a way is terrific, especially as my life was 10 years ago and it was in such a mess. To have turned my life around and to, you know, worked hard on myself and to be rewarded in such a way, after, you know, coming open with all the problems that I had, I thought it was quite amazing, actually.
It made me quite
to witness the playoff between this pair of piano men, Elton John in the yellow corner, face to face with Billy Joel, the likely lad in leather, across a crowded stage. It's the war of independence once again, only this time the combatants are on the same soulful side. The cool breeze off the Bahamas can't disguise the fact that some of this crowd have smoked themselves into a high state of expectation. Elton and Billy are only here to please, and they certainly do. Over 4 hours of piano pyrotechnics, a taste of what Australia can expect next February.
Solo artists in music history. On Saturday, March 7th, they'll share the one stage for the music event of a lifetime. Elton John and Billy Joel face to face. Two superstars together at Ericsson Stadium. Tickets on sale Monday. Elton John and Billy Joel. Together they share the stage in one of the greatest shows ever. And they're next up at Ericsson Stadium, Auckland, March 7th and 8th. Good seats still available for March the 8th. You can tell everybody. Elton and Billy are fantastic, and you can still see them March the 8th. Tickets at Ticketek.